happened, that is, we could not record. Then what do we do in order to rectify this? What can be done? Yes, anyone?
Sir, we should record that.
Yes, it's so simple. If you forgot to record an entry, you record it now. Suppose you deposited money in bank and you forgot to record. So the only very simple course of action could be that you record it. Okay, how about error of repetition? Suppose you recorded a transaction twice. It is an error. How do we correct that error?
So by passing
an entry. Say a bit louder, Subhia.
Maybe by passing an entry which includes the deduction of that particular amount.
Okay. Just I give you an example. Rather, I am asking you with the help of an example. You deposited money in the bank and you made an entry. The entry you made, correct entry, naturally should be bank account debit to cash account. We are discussing error of repetition. Suppose this has been done twice. You wrote bank account debit to cash account once, and again after 5-10 entries or after any number of entries, you once again wrote bank debit to cash account. So this is an error of repetition. How would we rectify this? What do we do?
So by reversing the entry.
Yes, we will not cross it like you do with a pen and scrub it. No, we will just make a reverse entry. What reverse entry will you make? Cash account debit to bank account. Something which was wrongly debited will be credited, and something which was wrongly credited will be debited. So this is how a reverse entry will be made. So this is one example of rectification of error. One example of rectification of error. Suppose you violated accounting principle. Can you still recall what is error of principle? Yes, anyone can tell me what is error of principle?
Sir, violating any convention.
Like?
The 12 convention that is there.
For example, just come up with an example.
So like recording expected gains or ignoring expected losses.
Conservatism.
This is what all of you are saying. What all of you are saying are an example of the principles of the conventions. I am asking a situation wherein you recorded something in violation of one of these conventions. You tell me that this is how the concept was violated. For example, if I ask you, give an example where accountant has violation matching concept. Is the question clear? I am writing the question in chat box. Give an example where accountant has violated matching concept. Where accountant has violated matching concept. So what example can be given?
So there is mismatch in the expense and the revenue, like expense is written for the 12 month and revenue for the 13 month.
It is only a part of example. Okay, let us understand one thing right at this stage. Whenever you are asked to illustrate something, so you have to write with example and the correct relevant example. What we have said is an explanation. It is not illustration. From the examination point of view, either sessional or final examination, one should be clear about the difference between explanation and illustration. If you are asked to illustrate matching concept, the one that I just talked about, what you have explained, it is an explanation. You will not qualify for 100% marks. You will deserve or you will qualify for 100 marks only if it is an illustration. Let me give you one example, and then the rest of it, you try and later on answer exactly in this way. illustration could be matching. The bill was received in the month of December. For 3 months. A bill was received in the month of December for 3 months. 3 months means bill for November, December, and January. The company is closing account on 31st December. That means the bill of January should be counted in the next accounting year. If the accountant records all these as expenses in this accounting year, he is violating matching concept, because revenue we are counting for 12 months and expenses we will be counting for 13 months because we are including January. Let me give another example. Suppose you have taken a building on rent. And your agreement with the landlord is that the rent will be paid every quarter. Suppose you pay quarterly rent in December. So you will be paying rent for the month of December now and 3 months in advance. That is January, February, and March. It is not necessary that you will hire a building in coinciding with your accounting years. It can be hired any day. Suppose you hired in December and the agreement was paying it for every 4 months. So if you are paying rent for 4 months and recording it also in the same accounting year, you are violating matching concept, because matching concept says expenses and revenue have to be matched for the same time period. By writing the entire expenses in this accounting year, that is expenses even up to March of next year, the accountant is violating matching the concept. So this is how the illustration works. Likewise, I'll give you one more example and then I'll move to some other part of discussion. Likewise, a businessman, a sole trader, paid tuition fees of his kids and recorded in the books of account as general expenses. So which concept has he violated?
Entity.
He has violated entity concept. So if you are asked to illustrate, so this way your illustration of violation of entity concept will be correct. Merely explaining that entity concept means personal expenses should not be mixed with organizational expenses, and entity also means that everything is held, everything is recorded, everything is transacted only and only in the name of business, not the owner of business. These are two separate entities in the eyes of law. So if you explain it this way, then only purpose of illustration will be answered correctly, otherwise not. Now I was asking you how to explain or how to illustrate the concept of the violation of any concept, and the point of discussion was error of a principle. How do we violate error of principle? Before I continue, I'll just close this chat. I'll just copy this chat box. Have you all mentioned your names and roll numbers? If someone still has not, he may do it right now so that I can copy it and then take it to the record. Okay, let me copy it and take it to record before I continue. All right. So, error of principle is committed. We should know how to do that. If we have committed a compensating error, we should know how to correct that, how to rectify that. By rectification, I mean correcting it or doing it properly. So the important principle is that we do not cross out the transactions if we are writing them manually. We do not do it even if we are writing it, you know, electronically, but we pass another entry which changes the transactions, which reverses the transactions, or which corrects the transaction. So this is what we do. Now we proceed. If there is nothing to ask, I'll continue. Up to this stage, if there is any question, you can seek a clarification. If you don't have any question, I'll proceed and take up what is for the next day. Can any one of you recall what was for the next day?
Case study of
Calcutta Motors. Okay. What is the reference given there in the statement? Reference I have provided Bhattacharya and Dearden. Okay. Now, in order to discuss case study, one must have studied this case. Has any one of you gone through this case? Anyone? Is my question not clear to you? I have just written a question. Has any one of you read the case of Calcutta Motors?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Okay. Then tell me, what is the advantage or what is the point in giving you something as advanced as 50 days ago? See, this we plan to discuss in about 48 days or 50 days. What we intend to discuss every day, I have given you in advance. What is the purpose? See, the purpose is not to discipline myself. What I'm supposed to do, I should be, it's not that important. What is more important, that you are all expected to read and, you know, come prepared for the discussion or for understanding or for listening what was supposed to be discussed on a particular day. So in line, today's we were supposed to discuss Calcutta Motor case. I have also provided the reference. It should have been taken from a book authored by Bhattacharya and Dearden. So this you would have done it only if you have gone through this, and you should have. So now it cannot be discussed because you have not read it. In future, make sure that you, whatever is mentioned, you read that before you come to the class. Only then the purpose of, you know, giving you everything in advance will be served. All right. So this I'll not take up now. I'll leave it to you. You should read it. And once you are ready, once you have read it twice, thrice, and you are ready for the discussion, we will decide a date and time. Perhaps we may request Parvez Sahab to allow us to combine a class because it will take longer time, and we will discuss in that class. So I'll wait for a response from you. Once you are ready, we will discuss that case. Next is recording closing entries and preparation of financial statements. Before we take up the first part of it, that is recording entries, recording closing entries and preparation of financial statement. Closing entries I'll take up later. I'll explain to you how to prepare the financial statements. This portion, closing entries, I'll hold it for some time, maybe for a day or two. This aspect I'll discuss only after we complete our discussion on preparation of financial statements. Okay. Again, come back to the presentation part, the slides. I'll go to the next one. Okay. Can you recall the trial balance? I'll show you what is the trial balance. This is your trial balance. Okay. In each of these, I think I have discussed it before also, all of them, all these 11 will belong to one or the other category. How many categories are there? Only 5. These will belong to only 5 categories. What are those 5 categories?
So assets, liabilities, capital.
A bit louder.
So assets, liabilities, capital, expenses, and revenue.
Revenue, you are right. So these will belong to any of these 5 categories. Now look at this, what I have written. What we will do, our steps would be that against each one of these items, against each one of them, we will write one of these. Against each, we will write either A or C or L, depending on what it is. So this you can do only if you are clear what is A, what is E, what is C, what is E, what is R. This we have been talking for quite long. So I hope you would be clear. All of them would belong to these categories. All 6, all 11 will belong to one of these categories. instead of 11, there can be 110, there can be 1100, 11,000 items. Let there be any number of items, all of them would belong to any of these categories. The first step in the preparation of financial statement would be classify all items of trial balance as asset, capital, liability, expense and revenue. Once you do that, you have to put them in some proper way. I'll tell you which proper way. For example, you will put them into two different statements. One statement is in front of you here, another statement is in front of you here. First statement that is there now, you call it as profit and loss account, in which you will write all expenses and income. The profit and loss means in a statement in which you are calculating either profit or loss, what has happened to the business. Even if you leave the accounting language for a time being, for a minute, how do you calculate profit and loss? You calculate revenue, you calculate expenses and take the difference between the two. If your revenue is 10, your expenses are 9, you made a profit of rupees 1 or vice versa. If your revenue was 10 and your expenses were 11, so you suffered a loss of rupee 1. So profit and loss account. Second statement you will prepare will be a balance sheet. Balance sheet means wherein you will record all balances. You will record on right hand side assets, on left hand side you will record capital and liabilities. So look at here, capital, liability, asset. So three elements you will write in this statement, two elements you will write in this statement. In this statement you will write revenue and expenses, in the next statement you will write asset, capital and liability. So all five classified heads of expenses will be tabulated, will be summarized in these two statements. I'll repeat. What are we doing? We are preparing financial statements. There are two financial statements, profit loss account and balance sheet. How do we prepare? From the trial balance, we classify all the items of trial balance here, all the items of trial balance into these five categories. Asset, capital, liability, expenses and revenue. All expenses and revenue we write in profit and loss account. All asset, capital and liabilities we write in balance sheet. So all five will be transferred or will be classified, will be shifted to two broad statements. One statement profit loss, the other statement balance sheet. In profit loss, revenue and expenses, in balance sheet, asset, capital and liability. So this can be prepared only if we are clear that out of these 11 or 1100 or 11,000, which head is what? Is it an expense or revenue or capital or asset or liability? If we are clear about it, preparation of these two statements will not be difficult. What do we do in profit loss account? What are we writing? We start with opening stock and we write all direct expenses. I am writing direct expenses because you are classifying expenses here. You are writing all expenses here. Expenses can further be classified into two categories, direct expenses and indirect expenses. Can you think of some example of direct expenses?
Salaries, rent.
Okay, let me first explain what is a direct expense. A direct expense is one which varies in proportion with the level of activities, which varies in proportion with the amount or with the volume of business. If you have more business, you will incur more expense. If you have less business, you will incur less expense. It is directly proportional to your volume of activity, to your engagements. Indirect expenses are, it doesn't matter how much do you do, or even you don't do, you sell more, you sell less, you close, you open, doesn't matter, but you will continue paying those expenses. That is the meaning of indirect expense. Now answer once again, what could be direct expenses? Yes.
Purchase
of goods. If you sell more, you will buy more. Otherwise, why would you buy? Okay, one example is purchases. Any other example?
Wages.
Say it again.
Wages.
There's a difference between wages and salaries. wages are paid according to the work done by somebody. Exactly according to work done by somebody. There are workers in the factory. If they produce 1 unit, they will get 10 rupees. If they produce 100 unit, they will get 1,000 rupees. If they produce 1,000 unit, they will get 10,000 rupees. If they produce no unit, they will get zero. That means this is in proportion to the amount of work they do. Contrary to this, salary is fixed monthly. Although it is also measured, but not directly. Sometimes you may be on leave. Sometimes, you know, you may do more. Sometimes you may do less. But payment of salary will not be dependent on the amount of work that you do, which can be directly measured. Another important example of indirect expenses could be, like salary I have given you, what could be another example of indirect expenses?
Depreciation.
Money spent.
Money is spent on?
Machine.
Advertisement.
Advertisement, okay.
Indirect.
Right. Any other example?
Sir, rent, in which the
factory. Very, very, very common example would be rent. Whether you stay in the building or you don't, you occupy building for 10 days or a month or maybe 15 days or 2 days, you come to, you do anything you want, but the landlord will charge you rent. So rent is an example of indirect expenses. So that means we will classify expenses into two categories, direct expenses and indirect expenses. All direct expenses will be written here one by one, like purchase of goods, salaries, fuel. Like this, we will write all. Then on this side, we will write net sales revenue. This side is revenue. Your credit side is revenue. And you can logically also understand why credit side should be revenue. Revenue increases capital. Capital increase in capital is credited. So we are writing in the credit side. Hold on for a second. Okay. We are writing in the credit side. So we will write net sales revenue. Net sales revenue means at times people returned also the goods that you sold. So sales made minus sales return will become your net sales, and then we will write closing stock of goods. So if you total this side and total this side, your difference could be either gross profit or gross loss. I'll repeat. Write revenue and closing stock here, right, opening stock and all expenses here. Difference between these two sides will either be profit, gross profit, or it will be gross loss. Now answer the question that I'm asking. Leaving the accounting, in general terminology, tell me when there will be a loss. Yes.
When
expenses are more and revenue is less. Now tell this in accounting language. Yes, yes, tell me in accounting language when you should say when debit side of profit loss account, which account is this? Profit and loss account. When debit side of profit loss account is more than the credit side, there will be loss.
No.
Am I right?
Yes, sir.
In case credit side of profit and loss account is more than the debit side, there will be profit. Which profit we are talking about? Gross profit or gross loss? Gross means we are taking only direct expenses. Only direct expenses. Now, difference between the two, if loss, we will write this side. If profit, we will write this side. That is the balancing figure. Balancing figure will either be here or balancing figure will be here. Correct? So we will write, suppose there is a profit, we will write gross profit here. Then we will write here indirect income. Sales was an example of direct income. What could be the example of indirect income?
No, activities.
Whatever you receive other than your normal revenue. Your normal revenue comes from sales. If you receive some discount, if you receive some commission, if you receive some rent, if you receive something other than like this, then it becomes an example of your indirect income. Then you write all indirect expenses such as rent, such as income tax, such as advertisement, such as legal expenses, such as bank charges, etc., etc. There's a long list of the expenses that you write in this side. And once again, total it. If your credit side is more, there'll be profit. And if debit side is more, there will be loss. So what do? We calculate all expenses, we calculate all revenue, take the difference. We will end up with either receipt getting a profit or a loss. Once we have done this, then we move on to the next statement. In this statement, now we have done all expenses and revenue. So what you will be left with? You will be left with asset and liabilities only, or asset, liabilities and capital, because in all there were five. I'll repeat, in all there were five: asset, capital, liability, expense and revenue. In one statement here, you have taken into consideration expenses and revenue. When two have been taken care of, expenses and revenue, what you will be left with? Asset, capital and liabilities. These three will be entered in this statement known as balance sheet. On left side, sorry, right side, you will write assets, all assets. On this side, you will write all capital and liabilities. Now, asset, you can write one by one, but for everything, law has prescribed a format. You will see the format as we reach a certain stage on certain days. I would have, you know, mentioned them. So we will write, we will, you know, here it is on page number, day number 22. You will see how it looks like. So you will have a format wherein you will write all assets in an order. That is, you cannot write the way you like. You write goods, you write building, you write furniture, you write cash, you write bank. No. For each, there will be a particular order in which these are to be written. For example, first they will be classified as fixed assets, loans and advances, current assets, miscellaneous assets, intangible assets, fictitious assets, etc., etc. In each category, you will write. For example, under fixed assets, you are writing building, furniture, machinery. Now, loans and advances. Loan can be given, loan can be taken. Advance can be given to somebody, advance can be taken from somebody. Can you tell me which loan and advance is this? Given or taken?
Given.
Given. Because when you give advance to somebody, when you give loan to somebody, only then it becomes your asset, because you will get it at a later date. If we write here on this side loans and advances, what would it mean? Loans and advances are taken, so that at a later date you will pay them back. So you will write fixed assets, you will write loans and advances, and then you will write current assets. These are the examples of current assets: cash, bank, debtors, stock. Can you think of some more examples of current assets? Okay, before I ask you this question, what difference do you find between these two heads, fixed assets and current assets? So what is the difference between these two?
So fixed assets are long-term assets, and current assets are which can be converted in cash in 12 months.
Cash into 12 months. Okay, any other answer? Any other explanation?
Sir, it is not about 12 months. It can be converted at any point of time.
Yes, it can be converted any moment. Within 2 seconds, it can be converted into cash. Your bank balance is as good as cash. Your debtors, you request them, and if they have money, they will pay you. The stock you sell, it becomes cash. So these can be converted very easily. They have very short term life. Very, very short term life could be, I mean, by all means, less than a year, less than 2 months. Their balances keep changing every day, several times. For a good regular business, the balance keeps on changing in these things several times a day. For example, a stock. A company which is dealing in this, let us say, scooters. Let us say Honda Activa. You see the showroom in this Maris Road. When they open a shop, they may have 1,000 scooters or motorcycles put together. In the evening, they may have 800. They might have sold 200. Maybe practically every 10 minutes they can be selling. So their balances changes very frequently. Cash. You have now, you spend money for buying tea, coffee, your cash balance reduces. Somebody gives you cash, your cash balance increases. Same holds good with bank. Is this applicable equally in these category of assets also? No. Balances of these assets changes usually. When does it change? Usually.
When you sell it.
Okay. Usually I am saying, so you can say usually it changes every year. You buy building, you charge depreciation. so balance will change. Unless you buy another building and sell, so buying and selling building, will it be very frequent? No, it will not be frequent at all. You don't buy building every day. Maybe once in 5, 6 years, 10 years you buy. If requirements are more, you buy again. So buying and selling furniture, buying and selling machinery does not happen on daily basis, not even on monthly or 4 or 6 monthly or yearly basis. So their balance will not change frequently. Maybe once in 5, 6 years, not, there's no rule, but relatively their balance will change very frequently. So these are your example of current asset. There can be several more examples here, several examples here. Then miscellaneous expenses. These are examples. One more thing I should write here. Let me write here. You can, you know, save this one. Intangible assets. Intangible assets. Intangible example will be goodwill. Then there will be goodwill, patents, etc. Then there will be fictitious assets. Fictitious assets. Example could be like this. Let me, I'll change the font size and you will see it properly. So there will be example of, like, you know, fictitious assets, or the example of fictitious assets I have mentioned here. So you will have another category of assets such as intangible assets. So what do you include intangible assets? Goodwill and patents, copyrights, etc., etc. Then you have miscellaneous expenditure not written off. This requires explanation. When there can be more examples here, when something is not really an asset, something is not really an asset, but it is written on the asset side just to satisfy the accounting equation, or as a matter of procedure that, or as a matter of requirement given to us by the rules which we consider in writing the business account, in writing the transactions. So when you do so, you write them in the asset side, which are not really your asset. These are not your asset, but you are writing them in the debit side. You are writing them in the asset side of the balance sheet. So one of the examples, goodwill is your intangible asset. It is an asset which you cannot see. Patents, again, copyrights, and this one. Then you have miscellaneous asset expenditure not written off till date. Written off, this also I'll explain to you. Let us say example, discount on issue of shares. So when a company issues shares on discount, in fact, this is just for the purpose of explaining to you, in reality, especially these days, this does not happen. It is not existing at all. Suppose a share is, the nominal price, a common price of a share is rupees 10. When company comes up with the initial public offering, it does not sell it for anything less than 10. It sells it for definitely much more than its face value. Now you note down an assignment. Go through any 5 IPOs, any 5 initial public offering IPOs. Note down at what price company offered their shares for the first time. Initial public offering means initially at what price company offered its share to the public in the market. So what you will do, you will make a table, serial number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. In next column you will write name of the company. In third column you will write price band. You should also try to understand what is price band. I can explain to you in a minute, but try to understand what is a price band. You will notice that the shares would have been issued far, far higher value than its nominal price, than its common price. Here it is just the opposite to that. A share of rupees 10 is being offered to the public for rupees 9. So 1 rupee discount is being given. So instead of showing it here on right side with the lesser value of share, they are writing this on the asset side so that mathematically it balances. I'll explain these things a bit later, a bit more. For the time being, let me also explain to you. I mean, it also requires explanation, preliminary expenses. Let me explain to you the other side so that at least the statement is complete. So you have written all A here, then you are left with C and L, capital and liabilities. you are writing capital here. If something has been drawn from the business by the owner, you subtract here. You add net profit that you calculated in this statement, net profit or loss. If there was loss, you would have subtracted. Then you write here long-term liabilities, you write here reserve and surplus, you write here current liabilities. Before I explain these, let me first explain current liabilities. What are current liabilities? Current liabilities are just opposite to your current assets. 100% opposite to your current assets. Here cash balances changes every time, several times a day. Here your liability also changes several times in a day. Creditors, people whom you have to pay. So the people whom you have to pay, you can pay some of them today, some of them are at 6 p.m., some of them at 4 p.m., some of you know, you continuously keep on entering into transactions. So creditors are your short-term liabilities or current liabilities. Bills payable. These are for the goods sold and purchased. These are for some other accounting transactions which requires further explanation. For the time being, you think it is a liability. Bank overdraft. You don't have money in bank and you have overdrawn. So it also keeps changing. So these are all some of the examples of current liabilities. On this side, you have written all assets. On this side, you are writing all liabilities and also you are writing capital. So your all five elements of the accounting equation have been taken care of. Expenses and revenues, you have entered here. Asset, capital, liabilities, you have entered here. When you do so, both side of your this statement should be equal. And they have to be equal because R minus E will increase your capital or decrease capital. Whatever has been increased or decreased, you have adjusted here. So you are left with only two, asset and capital, or asset and capital and liability. So the total of the both side is equal. If total of both of these side is equal, that means you are there is no mathematical error even up to this stage. So this is the example of, there are several other things also which we will discuss about these financial statements. They are not as easy as I have shown on the blackboard, on the screen. But we need to first be clear about transferring, and then when we do so, let me tell you that I did here. Assume that these are written in the format. All assets you are writing in the format, the total will be 116. Capital is 1 lakh. Your liabilities are 10,000. The revenues are so much. Expenses are so much. Your profit is so much. Added to capital, it is so much. Asset equal to capital plus liabilities. What I did, have a look at it for a minute. All assets are placed at one place, all capital at one place, liability one place, revenues at one place, expenses at one place, then revenue minus expenses. Finally, 6 is our profit, which will be added to capital. Once we do so, our assets will be equal to capital plus liabilities. This can be written in the form of two statements, profit and loss account and balance sheet. In profit loss account, this and this will be written. Your balancing figure would be 6 as a profit. In balance sheet, asset, capital, liability will be written. On asset side, total will be 116. Liability side, 10 and capital 100. And your answer will be 106 in both the places. So this is how we can ensure that our calculations are correct. If you look at this statement I have classified, this I have written in asset, this I have written in asset, this I have written in expense, capital, asset, liability, asset, revenue, expenses and revenue. So all of them were either asset or capital or liability. Written them in this format, the one that is appearing here and here, and you will get this total as 116. So what you do, a simple thing that you should do is now, one that I have told you, take out the thing of the IPO and note what is happening. Secondly, draw two statements, profit and loss account and balance sheet. Transfer these figures to two statements, profit loss account and balance sheet. This entire thing, transferring these 11 figures into two statements, profit loss and balance sheet, on relevant side, expenses on the expense side, revenue on the revenue side, take out the balance. Take this balance to the next statement, that is balance sheet. Write assets on one side, liabilities and capital on the other side. The entire exercise will not take more than 10 minutes. Do it as soon as you can. Then I'll ask you what is to be done. Once your classes are over, attempt them. Now, before I proceed, take you to the next task or give you some clarification, let me call today your attendance. By now, all of you have got your roll numbers. You all have got your roll numbers because you are writing roll numbers in the chat
box. Yes, sir.
Okay. First of all, I'll be calling the roll numbers of MBAs only. Only MBAs. MBA 1.
Yes, sir.
2. 3. Be quick. Kindly don't waste time. You are 3 or 2? 3. 4.
Yes, sir.
5. 6. 7. 8. 9.
Yes, sir.
8 or 9?
Sir, 8.
9. 10.
Yes, sir.
10 or 11?
Sir, 10. Present, sir.
10, 11. 11, both. 11, 10, 11, both. 12.
Present, sir.